Hello, I'm Campbell Barnett with the ninth and final part of High Notes and Home Runs, the story of trumpeter Harry James. Last week we heard how he and Betty Grable moved permanently to Las Vegas, the two sports fans buying a home which conveniently backed onto the Desert Inn golf course. Jack Nicklaus and Arnold Palmer were close friends, and Harry was on the invitation list to play at the annual Bing Crosby tournament. His passion for baseball continued, and he was considered one of the family at spring training with his beloved St. Louis Cardinals. The team's superstar batter, Stan the Man Musial, actually presented him with one of the club's scarlet warm-up jackets, which Harry frequently wore on tour. The band settled into a triumphant 9-year residency in the Driftwood Lounge of Las Vegas's Flamingo Hotel, with enough weeks off to undertake lucrative engagements elsewhere. And with drum star Buddy Rich on the payroll for 4 of those years, the band had never sounded better.
Thank you very much, ladies and gentlemen. Ernie Wilkins. Now we'd like to do an arrangement by Mr. Wilkins of the Great Duke Ellingtons. Composition featuring Buddy Rich at the drums, rockin' and rhythm. 1, 2, 3...
Harry was proud of his swinging band, but behind the scenes, things were less than perfect. He'd negotiated a gambling money allowance for use in the Flamingo Hotel's casino. But substantial as it was nowhere near enough for an addict. Harry could be as much as $20,000 down in a night, but wouldn't quit the table. If he'd read the poet Houseman instead of sports magazines, he would have discovered that the house of illusions is easy to build, but drafty to live in. Roulette, craps, baccarat, keno, they all claimed huge amounts from him. He borrowed heavily from Betty Grable, even writing her IOUs on the backs of book matches, money she would never see again. Betty Grable, now in her late 40s and no longer Hollywood's blonde cheesecake, returned to the world of stage musicals in Guys and Dolls. In 1965, she was signed to play the lead in the touring version of Hello, Dolly. With that contract in the bag, she hit the headlines again by ending another contract. She sued for divorce, claiming extreme cruelty, and not just mental cruelty, says the James biographer Peter Levinson. Harry's perfectionist father had beaten him regularly in childhood, and now the emotional scars seem to be surfacing.
I do know for a fact that he did beat Betty Grable quite a bit. I found out after the book was written that he broke her nose once. The violence in him was not really him, it was the alcohol more than anything else. Because he was a drinker like I've never seen any human being. He was just astounding in how much he could drink. I mean, he used to drink 2 quarts of bourbon a day. Now that's incredible.
Betty Grable was really wonderful, marvelous woman. Great sense of humor, great attitude, just marvelous. It was hard to understand why he didn't appreciate her in a different way. I'll never understand that whole thing, that's bizarre. We check into a hotel in Chicago one time, and he had booked 3 rooms, and he had a different girl in each room. And the whole night he went around in a circle. I think it was like a contest with him. Women were like a contest. I don't think it was liking or disliking. It was like a contest.
The the voice just now of drummer Jackie Mills, who was in and out of the James Band over the years and had worked as a studio musician on Grable movies. Her high-profile marriage had lasted for 22 years, and although it was Betty who filed for divorce, she was very, very upset by the whole business. Afterwards, she would occasionally turn up at Harry's gigs, sometimes sitting at the back, out of sight. By the time the Beatles took America by storm in the mid-1960s, a new flower power generation had no interest in dancing to swing bands, but plenty of other people did, especially in New York, at the Riverboat, for instance, an attractive night spot situated within the Empire State Building. Buddy Rich had left to form his own big band, but drummers had always been important to Harry James, so back came another favourite percussion star, Louis Belson. During its three-week engagement at the Riverboat, the James Band set new attendance records, and on the final night, more than 1,000 fans had to be turned away. Harry was updating the repertoire, too. The Batman TV theme music was topical. Batman was a tune to refuel the prejudices of those jazz purists who'd always resented the commercial side of Harry James. And they were even more dismayed by his album of country and western tunes, arranged and conducted by Jimmy Haskell. But to be fair to Harry, he wasn't too thrilled about the concept either.
He kind of confided in me just before the date started, and he said, "Jimmy, my mother told me that I'd have to have one day like this." Like, he really hated the idea of doing a country album. And so I went into the booth and I said, "Randy, Harry's not happy about doing this album." And Randy said, "I'm sure he's going to cry all the way to the bank."
Harry had been carrying on a long-term romance with a Las Vegas showgirl, Joan Boyd, 27 years his junior. They were married in January 1968, when Harry was fast approaching his 52nd birthday, and the third Mrs. James gave birth to a son, Michael Everett Anthony, in July. By this time, Harry's two daughters by Betty Grable were 24 and 21, and both were married. His two sons by his first wife, Louise Tobin, were 27 and 26, and now saw their father occasionally. Harry Jr. had become a featured trumpeter in the Air Force Band swing unit, but soon retired, turning instead to successful real estate development. Tim James graduated from the University of Houston Law School and became a district attorney in Texas. Recently, he was an American representative at the Kosovo War Crimes Tribunal.
Ladies and gentlemen, Mr. Harry James.
Harry James Band on foreign soil, in fact, here in Britain in October 1971 on a nationwide tour which included 3 nights at Ronnie Scott's Jazz Club in London. Ronnie's partner, Pete King, remembers the visit fondly.
Oh, for Ronnie and I, during that period, it was just an incredible thing. I mean, wonderful. One of the best trumpet players in the world, and he was actually bringing that wonderful big band into the club. You must remember in those days, for instance, every week or every engagement was a new thrill for Ronnie and I, and it was a new thrill, of course, to the many patrons that were coming in. Not only was the music fantastic, but usually the leader was a sensational personality. And this, in the case of Harry James, was exactly it. I remember Ronnie and I were completely overawed by the whole thing, yeah. I mean, anybody that had got into bed with Betty Grable's got to be good, haven't they?
Another in the great line of drummers to work for Harry, that was Sonny Payne in the engine room during the band's second British tour. Harry's alto sax star of so many years, the silky-sounding Willie Smith, had been fired in the mid-1960s for drinking too much, and one could almost pun and say a wry irony there. Harry's third marriage lasted just 1 year, and soon he felt the effects of a changing Las Vegas entertainment scene. His long-running contract with the Flamingo was not renewed, and he moved to the Frontier Hotel. There would now be more time on the band bus and also more work abroad. An earlier tour of Japan had been fabulously successful, as were trips to South America and appearances aboard luxury cruise ships. After his British trip in 1971, he returned alone to London to make an album sponsored by Longines Watches and using local session musicians. As a teenager, the ex-Ted Heath trumpeter Ronnie Hughes had adored Harry James. Now Ronnie had the chance to work with him.
He wasn't easy to get on with at that particular time, but he still played great. I remember at Decca Studios, we had the four trumpets were in the line. He was facing us in that box, but the sound that hit me, I'd never heard a sound like that before. I believe that he had a reputation of being quite a heavy drinker, and he was drinking quite heavily on this session, these particular sessions, and as the sessions went on and he was getting more and more, well, I wouldn't say drunk, he wasn't drunk by any means, but he got a little fractious, he got a little bit heavy, you know. His temper went a little bit, but nobody took too much notice of that, you know, not really, but he did drink a lot.
Early in the summer of 1972, Betty Grable became unwell. She cancelled a proposed tour of Australia playing in No No Nanette and was diagnosed with lung cancer soon afterwards. Despite that, she opened in Born Yesterday at Jacksonville, Florida in January 1973 and managed to complete the 8-week run. Harry was devastated when she told him of her terminal condition. Once the highest female earner in America, Betty Grable died early in July, just 56 years old, and her home had to be sold off to cover medical bills and outstanding taxes. In Peter Levinson's James biography, he tells of Harry's friends observing that he was never the same after Betty's death. He'd blown a wonderful marriage, says Levinson, and although the band still grossed $1 million a year, it meant nothing. The James Band now hit the road more and more. It's the grueling, mind-numbing routine of sitting for hour after hour on the bus, hundreds of miles every day, which eventually drives so many touring musicians into alternative employment. But Harry had been born into a circus. From 2 weeks old, he'd been traveling, and he knew nothing else all his life. Two of his long-serving musicians in the Latter Day Band, bassist Red Kelly and pianist Jack Percival, remembered the leader as the first man onto the bus every morning, heading with his sports magazines, newspapers and booze supply to his reserved seats in row 3 and saying, "Oh boy, it's just great being back on the road." Tough on the average person, perhaps, but comfortable territory for an old road rat like Harry. He would even get nostalgic, pull out his trumpet on the bus in the middle of the night, and play the second trumpet part of a Benny Goodman Band arrangement from 40 years earlier. He was very proud of his photographic memory. While rock music had almost all the headlines by the late 1970s, Harry managed to keep his gang in employment. Harry was seen in a TV ad demonstrating the strength of Kleenex tissues. Not even the James trumpet could blow a hole in them. His last movie appearance was a bit part in Sting 2, the sequel to the original Paul Newman Robert Redford classic. He cut 3 albums using the latest digital direct-to-disc technology, appeared at the Newport Jazz Festival, and in 1979 began a 3-year association with a nostalgia package called The Big Broadcast of 1944. It toured theatres using the format of the old radio shows he'd so often been part of. His 1940s singers Helen Forrest and Dick Hames were also on board to sing those famous old hits. In her autobiography, published in 1981, Helen was affectionately scornful of Harry's womanizing, but added that Harry was at his happiest playing a beautiful ballad. He was at peace, and he knew he was loved when he was playing trumpet. He knew nobody could hurt him. By the early 1980s, the decades of hedonism were catching up with Harry James. His teeth had crumbled, he was dyeing his hair a ludicrous colour, and suffering bouts of self-recrimination about his treatment of Betty Grable. Here's his biographer, Peter Levinson, again.
The end of his life, of course, his stomach was in such terrible shape that he could only have a tiny bit of bourbon with scalding hot tea, because he had cirrhosis. He had lost his teeth, and I think that's probably from not good care, but also all the sugar and the alcohol. You drink like that, and it's going to affect your teeth. And a trumpet player has to have good teeth.
Colleagues became worried about his appearance. He was losing weight, and when a growth appeared on his neck, it was diagnosed as a cancerous tumor. After surgery, he doggedly continued to do well-paid gigs on the road. On June the 23rd, he turned up to play what would be the last Harry James performance of a career stretching back more than 60 years. The cancer had spread, and he was in agony, but the show went on.
Lost the professionalism on the bandstand. Even at the end when he had this, if you can imagine a man having cirrhosis of the liver, cancer in his gallbladder and his lung, and playing a wind instrument. And he probably played about 6 to 8 gigs in that condition. What his father had instilled in him, which was, you're there to play the gig, the audience is there to see you, you owe them a performance, never, never went away from him.
His final performance had been at a private function for the International Association of Building Owners and Managers at the Century Plaza Hotel in Los Angeles, a mundane contrast to his days as a Hollywood star and his circus nights as a 5-year-old contortionist in the early 1920s. He returned to Las Vegas early the next morning to hospital. All his children arrived, and although heavily sedated, Harry was very moved to see them. An attractive young woman, Anita Bradshaw, hovered around the ward. It was the girlfriend he'd planned to marry. Given the last rites by a priest, he died 2 days later on the 5th of July, 1983, coincidentally the 40th anniversary of his wedding to Betty Grable and also the 10th anniversary of her funeral. 3 5s. The gambling Mr. James's numbers had come up at last, but in the cruelest way. Frank Sinatra asked that he might deliver the eulogy in church, and Harry's close buddy, comedian Phil Harris, was also there to shake the hands of all 200 mourners. Harry James was buried in Edendale Memorial Park, Las Vegas, wearing his St. Louis Cardinals baseball jacket. The absence of a conventional childhood, very little education, and the severe expectations of his father, maybe these accounted for Harry's Jekyll and Hyde personality. His psychological turmoil, innate loneliness and low self-esteem caused him to put up the barriers. Alcohol numbed the pain, women eased the inner isolation, and gambling provided thrills. But Peter Levinson suggests he was the man nobody knew. A flashing smile one day, an icy stare the next. His private behavior often distressed and confused his family and associates. To have a band which grossed $60 million, to have blown a third of that at the racetrack and gambling tables, and to eventually leave a paltry $10,000 to one's offspring is irresponsible behavior. But where Harry James always connected with passionate sincerity was through music. His trumpet had taught the language of love to young and old during emotionally disturbing times, and it had also thrilled the thousands of Tyro jazz musicians who had the ambition to play hot. Over the years, hundreds of top-class professionals have endorsed his amazing gifts. And you know, Harry even suggested his own epitaph. He's doing a one-night stand in Gabriel's band. Perhaps Helen Forrest was right when she said, "He was at peace and knew he was loved when he played the trumpet. He knew nobody could hurt him." Our thanks to Peter Levinson, author of the Harry James biography, Trumpet Blues, to our man in Los Angeles, Mike Reynolds, to collectors Tony Middleton, Maurice Rolfe and Charlie Crump, to Jim Cutler of the Harry James Appreciation Society, and to other generous friends. A special thank you to the first Mrs. James, Louise Tobin, who emerged from the whole chaotic story with great style and dignity, and continues in the music business as Mrs. Peanuts Hucko. Finally, from me, Campbell Barnap, and my fellow Harry James buff, producer Roy Oakeshott, thank you for listening to our series. Goodbye.